Wendell Berry has said that the world cannot be discovered by a journey of miles, no matter how long, but only by a spiritual journey, a journey of 1 inch, very arduous and humbling and joyful, by which we arrive at the ground at our own feet and learn to be at home. Let us take a spiritual journey together this year, a pilgrimage of learning to be at home. Together, we will leave the safety and comfort of the familiar and test our mettle in an arduous and humbling and joyful journey. It will be difficult at times, but we will face the unfamiliar together. There will be times of grieving to release what we've lost and times of celebration to renew our resolve. Through it all, we will learn together to widen our horizons, deepen our hearts, and release our limitations so that we might know each other and ourselves anew.
Good morning. Let us listen to the Peace Bowl. And especially today, let us put our energy towards peace on this earth. This morning, as we recall our ancestors, let us recall the traditional names of the four groups that make up the Yavapai we know today: the Wipukepas, the Tokepayas, the Cuevkepayas, and the Yavape. Let us think of their ancestors and our own. Who is on our altar, on our ofrenda, in the opening, in the entryway of our building? Listen to Karen Hagberg. Tell us about that.
Altar was made by the RE kids, honoring New Orleans after the big hurricane that went through, the very first big one, Katrina. And then several people from our church, including youth, went down to help rebuild. So I keep this one every year. Oh. And some of the collectibles are just things that I really like. We have a beer bottle for my brother, kazoo for mom. This is my friend Virginia Spiller, who introduced me to UU. She came into the restaurant where I was a waitress. She always wore a hat and unique jewelry. And when she passed away, I found out that she also loved bullfighting and sponsored a bullfighter, his training, his education, and his costumes. And she had a big bullfighting wall. But she was just a unique character who introduced me to UU. So she's there. So we have lots on our wall that we like. Oh, and pets are important too. I have my pet wall, especially for kids.
In the last scene of the movie Coco, which if you have not seen it, I hope you rent it and watch it this evening. At the very end, people who were separated by misunderstanding come together on both sides of that veil, separating the living and those who have gone before. Anything is possible. A boy forbidden to play a guitar becomes a famous musician. Let us listen to those possibilities.
Good morning. And welcome to Granite Peak Unitarian Universalist Congregation in Prescott, Arizona. I'm Karen Hagberg, and I'm honored to be your worship associate today. We extend a warm welcome to all of you. We're glad you're able to join us, and we hope that we find you all in good health. We want to stay connected, so please join us for breakout rooms after the service. This gives us time to chat with other congregants in small groups. And if you are joining us for the first time, please check out our website for more information. It's prescottuu.org. This is the mission statement of our congregation. We are a compassionate spiritual community that celebrates diversity, nurtures the personal and spiritual growth of all ages, shares our gifts, promotes justice for all, and serves the world in which we live. Our message today, Who Are Still With Us, is presented by Reverend Patty Willis. We extend our thanks to all who contribute to the presentation, the service today, including Heather Knowles for technical direction and Mary Lou Prince for musical direction, and for all who contributed pictures and their stories. We thank you. Although we are physically apart, we are still in community and we continue some of our meetings and gatherings via the internet. So please continue to check your weekly peek, the website, and Reverend Patty's videos. And to see this and other services, connect to our YouTube channel. The link can be found in the order of service or in your weekly peek newsletter. And don't forget, we have regular weekly Zoom meetings as well. Together Wednesday Forum, Wednesday Afternoon Storytelling, and Friday Lunch with the Minister. Find connection information and other announcements in the order of service. The Children's Faith Development will be at 11:30 today via Zoom. Bev's contact information is in your order of service. Hey, did you know our annual service auction is still happening? Nod your heads. Yes, we know. We have a kickoff on November 9th. We want everyone to participate, but we are still in need of some donated services and items and even events to offer for this auction and fundraiser. Please contact Marianne Erickson by November 4th, that's this Wednesday, with all your donations. And also, if you're experiencing financial difficulties at this time, please contact Marianne Clark for a bidding scholarship made available from a donation. And now we begin our service in the Unitarian Universalist tradition of lighting our chalice. Today's reading for All Souls Day by Florence Kaplow. As we kindle this flame, we honor and remember those who have passed into the mystery. Their brightness lives on in our vision. Their courage lives on in our commitments. And their love continues to bless the world through us. We light this chalice, a symbol of our heritage, in gratitude for this beloved community.
Good morning, everyone. Doesn't Karen look amazing? My gosh, that's wonderful. Woo! I wonder if you feel as I do, that we are in the midst of history. We're living it out right here, this moment. And I think for those of you who are young enough, live long enough, I think that 30 years from now, young people are going to be asking, maybe even 20 years from now, what was it like during that time? In the midst of a pandemic that is not getting better, so please keep practicing safety. In the midst of that, we are having an election, not just any election, and apocalyptic scenarios are growing out of social media like pigweed after a monsoon rain. And the sun rose yesterday. And today, and the blue moon was still in the sky when the sun peeked over the mountains. Did you see the moon rise last night? Did you see the joy in the faces of children in costumes? Because despite the pandemic and all of the crazy news, parents and neighbors were finding a way to have Halloween. Let us find hope and respite in the words of Wendell Berry, the words that are used with the photographs as we begin our time together. They're in the words of that video that Heather created from, and they are chosen by Lucy Beckner, because we are at a point now in our pilgrimage that is unsettling. And I wonder, could this journey be calling us to a new way of being at home, together and in the world? Let us be awake to this moment during the next few excruciating days. For, as Wendell Berry says, the world cannot be discovered by a journey of miles, no matter how long, but only by a spiritual journey, a journey of one inch, very arduous and humbling and joyful, by which we arrive at the ground at our own feet and learn to be at home. May we use this time to learn to be at home. And let us sing together. Remember, you are muted. You can sing your hearts out no matter what voice you have. Let us sing together, Where My Free Spirit Onward Leads. Please join me in saying our covenant. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest for truth, its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve others in community. Thus do we covenant together. And now let us hear of our tradition, this tradition of Day of the Dead. Why do we have an ofrenda in the entryway of our building? Let's listen to Karen Hagberg again.
Día de los Muertos is Day of the Dead. It's celebrated as a Mexican traditional holiday honoring spirits who are said to visit once a year of those who we have lost before us. Tradition has you celebrating your family members and relations. But Day of the Dead is important to me because it is that one day of the year when I can remember people who have gone before me, not just my family, although I do honor my mother and her like for Hershey chocolate and Diet Pepsi and kazoos. And I honor my other family members, but I also remember family members that were from my church congregations. I have names up that are said only once a year. I hope that their spirits hear me honoring their names. And I include names of people I have worked with. I do it for myself every year, and I'm honored to be able to do it for you as well. One of the names on my board is Ron Januesk. He is a simple man who worked with me in a manufacturing plant. He came to work each day. He lived in a single room. He chose not to hang out with people. He was often invited to Thanksgivings and Christmases and turned us down. He chose not to have a television. And what he did was every night handwrite chapters of books on loose leaf paper so he could send them to prisoners who couldn't receive books with bindings. When Ron became ill and his disease caught him off guard and quick, we could not locate a family member for over 4 weeks. Ron is always going to be remembered every Day of the Dead for me because he had a wonderful sense of humor, he used his spare time to give to others, and he lived a good life. And that is what I like to do on Day of the Dead, is remember those before me whose names I won't think about except on that day when I take out my collection of altar items and look them over and call those names out loud. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you. And now let us listen again to this sound. And I invite you into a time of meditation. Let us find at first that in the midst of all of the craziness of this time, let us find that still place within us, that place that has been called the still point of the turning world. Anchoring ourselves in that stillness, let us feel our feet on this earth. Remember the feel of the earth when you're hiking. Just the feel of putting your bare feet on summer grass. Let us consider how this earth has held us up and will hold us up through this week, through this time. As in all of the times that we gather together with joy and sorrow. Today, especially, let us think of those who are leaving our community. Pocahontas and Jean Gertler are leaving this week. They will be resettling in Delaware where they can have closer family and more intensive care. They leave a wonderful legacy in the West. We also hold Janer Eldridge, who is with us, not going anywhere. She is now in hospice, and I will bring her love, your love to her this afternoon when I visit. I also bring you the great news that Karen Anderson is home. And if hearing that inspires us a vision of a beautiful meal to brighten their days, then please be in touch with Nancy Beeson. We have sorrow that Bill and Sherry Betts are resettling in Tucson. They will be missed, as will Gary Baker and Molly Devine and Connie Tobiah. And we are holding and hoping with Gary and Molly that there will be months before the real goodbye, and that we mean so much that they will keep coming back, as Sherry and Bill are promising. All these people who have spent time with us will remain with us. I now invite you in this time after I ring the bell to say the names of those who are on your hearts and minds. I also invite you to say the names of your ancestors and hold this nation in a time of silence, which I will end with a prayer meditation. Spirit of life, we are here. We are showing up in this place together. We hold with us today those who have gone before, and also those who are connected with us, who are feeling joy or sorrow. We hold those who are in the process of leaving this community. May they know that we travel with them and that they will stay with us. We ask for wisdom and peace in this country. We ask for peace that is grounded in justice. We ask for calm in our hearts. We ask for ways of overcoming fears and anxiety. We ask to be nimble in this moment, to be ready to reach out our hands in compassion, to be ready to believe in the goodness of people around us. Let us hold our nation. In the hands of this community, let us hold it in love, and let us hold our visions of transformation, our hopes, our commitment to the work of justice. And may this community continue to be well and practice all of those things that we know we must do in order to keep safe in this pandemic. All these things we ask in your many names. Amen. And may it be so. And now please join in singing Walking, Walking With You. Walking, walking with you, walking with you is my prayer.
This is the time we consider the offering. Let us embrace the feeling of connection and community that we have when we gather each week, even here on Zoom. Let's remember that this congregation and its programs are supported by your generosity. We also give back to the greater community through our Seeds of Support program. During the month of November, we are supporting the continued work of LINC, Latino Immigrant Network Coalition, and your donations will assist in funding the annual Christmas event, which will be modified during this COVID time. Please read more details about them in your order of service and the newsletter. To give during this distance time, please go to prescottuu.org and select the donate button. The link is also available today in the chat room. What is given in love is received in gratitude. Blessed be. And now please enjoy, and as Reverend Patty has said, sing along. No one can hear you, and you love this song as we listen to Spirit of Life.
Sing of love, come to me. Sing.
Ancestors did grand things, and others lifted our lives by the way that they noticed the world around them, by the way they reached out to people in need, by the way they brought beauty into their lives, even when from the outside their lives appeared to be falling apart, as Julia Cameron's grandmother.
Flora and Fauna reports. I used to call the long winding letters from my grandmother. The forsythia is starting, and this morning I saw my first robin. The roses are holding even in this heat. The sumac has turned, the little maple down by the mailbox. My Christmas cactus is getting ready, and so on. Life through grandma's eyes was a series of small miracles. The wild tiger lilies under the cottonwoods in June, the quick lizard scooting under the gray river rock she admired for its satiny finish. Her letters clocked the seasons of the year and of her life. She lived until she was 80, and the letters came until the very end. When she died, it was as suddenly as her Christmas cactus had bloomed. My grandmother lived with her husband in tiled Spanish houses, in trailers, in a tiny cabin halfway up a mountain, in a railway flat, and finally in a house made out of ticky-tack where they all look the same. "I don't know how she stands it," my mother would say, furious with my grandfather for some new misadventure. She meant she didn't know why. The truth is, we all knew how she stood it. She stood it by standing knee-deep in the flow of life and paying close attention. My grandmother was gone before I learned the lesson that her letters were teaching. Survival like insanity, and sanity likes in paying attention. Yes, her letter said, "Dad's cough is getting worse. We've lost the house. There's no money. We're out of work. But the tiger lilies are blooming. The lizard has found a spot in the sun. The roses are holding despite the heat." My grandmother knew what a painful life had taught her. Success or failure, the truth of life really has little to do with quality. The quality of life is in proportion always to the capacity for delight. The capacity for delight is the gift of paying attention.
Around us, among us, are the people who went before us. We are given their names, as I was, the great-grandmother Patty and her grandmother Patty. We are given their stories, their examples, their good and bad deeds, their love, their disdain, their resilience, and the complexity of human life. These are the photos you sent us. Let us see those faces of ancestors who are among us in our community, What are they saying? How are they living on among us? Wasn't that wonderful? And some of you sent me stories. And of all of the stories that we are talking about today, it seemed timely to begin with Drew's mother, who was caught in the pandemic after World War I. Her survival brought us Drew.
Among these photos is one from Drew Potter, about his mother. This is what he wrote. My mother, Lucille Frisbee, was born in the tiny farming town of Pine River in the middle of Wisconsin. When the U.S. entered World War I, Lucille somehow found the telephone number for an army office in Washington. She called and asked for a job and was told to report for work as soon as possible. Over the objections of her family, she boarded a train for Washington, paying the fare with the $100 her dad gave her to promise not to smoke before age 21. She never did smoke. The Spanish flu pandemic was near its peak then, killing thousands. Lucille caught the flu and spent time in the hospital, but happily recovered, for which I am grateful.
In Mexico, ofrendas, these altars that celebrate the dead, appear at this time, and in true Mexican fashion, and those of you who attended Suki's beautiful presentation on Thursday, you have seen how these ofrendas, as Karens, have become works of art, combining the human need for connection with those who have gone before, with a love of color and texture and food. We who grew up with different cultural traditions still have this need, and we see ofrenda-like places here and there in people's houses. In some homes, pianos become places from which the portraits of those who went before stare down at us when we play. In my two studies, one in my home and one at the Granite Peak building, I use the glass-faced shelves for photographs of people who have become important to me, including my parents, a great-great-grandmother, and a dear friend. Others, my great-grandmother Patty, for example, are remembered by what they left me, a Hawaiian quilt that I keep on the back of a love seat, and her husband, Wilder True Hatch. His keepsakes are on my desks and in purses, in the form of cowrie shells that he brought back from the Sandwich Islands, where he was a missionary before the turn of the century. They were in a decorative cookie box in my great-grandmother's living room in Lovell, Wyoming, and I inherited 10 or so of those shells, and now they found their way into my daily life as reminders of him, a man I did not know, the father of my beloved grandmother. He died before he was 30. I wonder if you have a wall, perhaps a hallway, covered in photographs that remind you many times each day as you pass by. K.K. Munson wrote about her ancestor. It doesn't have a photograph, so please think of a woman named Emma Smith Johnson in an elegant brown silk dress on her wedding day. She wrote, "The Smiths were not rich by any means. Homesteading in eastern Nebraska had been hard, but education was important, and Emma and her sisters attended the infant University of Nebraska, though she didn't finish. And when she was ready to make her wedding dress, her father told her he would buy her as many yards of silk as she could cut a continuous strand of an apple peel, because that is such a critical skill for a woman, no? I have seen that dress. It was made of 7 yards of heavyweight brown silk fail with more tiny cartridge pleats than you can imagine. It was an elegant Sunday best dress." KK also told me that her grandmother, Phoebe Johnson Harms, Emma's eldest daughter, taught her little sister, then age 3, to make pies in the summer kitchen and the wood-burning stove when Phoebe herself was just 5. So her sister was 3. I think I might have said 5. Knives, matches, fires. KK finishes with, we used to be made of stiffer stuff. I love the idea of an ofrenda. I think I love it very much because it's just once a year, a concentrated time of remembering. I wonder if having this celebration once a year encourages people to include everyone. Why not? That person, that relative that we're not really crazy about for various reasons, will be gone after a week. And then there are others we cherish and we keep on our phones. Here is a photograph from Lena Huben's collection of important family photos, photos that are worthy of her ofrenda, wherever it is, in her house or in her heart. Listen to her story.
These are all ancestors of mine, wrote Lena Huben. Mom at Far Right in overalls, but the special one for now is my Grandma Welch, a.k.a. Margaret Vetters Welch, second from left in apron and big smile, arms outstretched to hold her entire family. Always a homemaker, farmer, she once shot a squirrel intended for supper that hung dead on a high limb forever because she couldn't get it down. She only finished eighth grade, but from grade school through college, I loved spending nights in her tiny house in town, just her and me, where I could hear trains go by and I had to walk around her table full of African violets to get some canned food from the basement. She tended rows of gladiolas in her garden too, and she played the harmonica. For breakfast, she made me cream of wheat with lumps in it and brown sugar on top, my favorite. She told me she'd once seen the ghost of her mother on the stairs, and she taught me to say, "Go put the doll to bed," in German. We joked and laughed, which felt rare in my family. My grandmother Welch taught me fun and sheer, unadulterated love.
Not all the people on our ofrendas share our DNA or have ever been linked to us through marriage. On Bobby Bollinger's ofrenda, along with her parents, she would have a photograph of a mentor who made a big difference in her life. Here is Bobby's story.
Good morning. I want to tell you about one of my mentors, my elementary school music teacher, Mrs. Betty Nash. Mrs. Nash taught music to first through sixth graders and instilled in most all of us a real love of all kinds of music. I remember that across the back wall of her classroom, she had pictures of every one of the instruments in the symphony orchestra, and we had to memorize that list of wind, strings, brass, and percussion instruments and recite them to the class annually. That list stayed with me for decades, and it went something like flute, piccolo, oboe, English horn, clarinet, bass, bassoon, contrabassoon, harp, violin, viola, cello, double bass, French horn, trumpet, trombone, blah, 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 blah. Besides that list, additionally, she prepared our classes very well each year to attend the annual Tulsa Symphony Youth Concert. Not only did our classes arrive being familiar with all of the works to be played that day, because she had prepared us so well, also we were very proud of the fact that the conductor of the Tulsa Symphony Orchestra lived right across the street from our school. And we felt somehow ownership of that and very proud that he lived so close by. I always felt like I was passing the home of a celebrity when I walked past his house every day on the way home from school. Mrs. Nash's Christmas pageants were something to behold, or at least I thought so at the time. Surely there had never been a chorus of such beautiful voices as all of us 6 through 11-year-olds in white choir robes singing Ave Maria with lit candles that miraculously never caught any of us on fire. I attribute my experiences with Mrs. Nash to my love of symphonic music and the reason that I had season tickets for so many years to the Phoenix Symphony. I really know very little about music and composers, but I do know that attending the symphony is food for my soul. Thank you, Mrs. Nash.
Thank you, Bobby. And wouldn't Mrs. Nash be happy to know that she's being remembered in this moment? You know, that movie Coco tells the story of someone who's missing from the ofrenda. The childhood photograph of the grandmother Coco has only her mother in the photograph. The father is missing. That beautifully animated film that I highly recommend for a watch tonight tells the story of how the father made his way back to the altar and completed their family circle. That story was told in the beginning music we listened to after ringing the peace bowl. The little boy, the great grandson who longs to be a musician, goes into the afterworld and meets his great grandfather who was a musician. And he unravels the mystery, the misunderstanding that kept him away from the ofrenda. There are many reasons for someone to keep a relative or someone close out of the ofrenda or our wall of people with whom we have connections. I wonder, think for a moment, is there anyone missing from yours? Who is missing? Why are they missing? I have heard people talk about the difficulty of coming to terms with ancestors involved in enslavement. In the preceding video of many different ancestors, did you notice the very old one of the man in a funny costume? That man was the brother of Joan Brown's ancestor. And the caption, which was very tiny letters, also revealed that he had freed 500 people who were enslaved. Wouldn't it be nice if all our ancestors had done things like that? During the past few years, as Unitarian Universalists have been leading what is a rethinking of history, many of us have been forced to see our own ancestors differently. I have come to see how the involvement of my ancestors with the settlement of both the East and the West connects them with the suffering of Indigenous people. Some of the ancestors of our community arrived through the middle passage of enslavement on boats. Some were part of one of the Indigenous groups who have lived on this land for thousands of years. Some came over as ship captains. Some came escaping genocide. Some came dreaming of streets paved in gold. Some came as indentured servants. Some came in search of freedom. And most of us have a combination of the above in our ancestry. It's hard to hear something negative about relatives and friends or even someone we admire in the greater world of famous people. And when we hear something or our perspective shifts on ancestors, sometimes we take them from what we thought was they were in the good person category. We push them into the bad person category. We kind of have that sort of cancel culture that happens all the time on Facebook, and I believe is so damaging. We push them out. And sometimes we go through lots of gyrations by trying to say that they were good, even though they did very bad things. Perhaps our fixation on seeing them as good or bad, and I have been there with this. Perhaps it takes us away from the real work of the ofrenda, which I believe is to keep taking these relationships with our ancestors a step further, deepening, forgiving, railing against them, and reaching out our arms. And that can be cyclical over and over again. They were our ancestors, whatever they did, and some brought us privilege. I know mine did. They handed down privilege to us. And in some cases, I've wondered, are they also handing us the chance to do reconciliation? Perhaps a fresh question around this could be, now that our eyes are open and we can see that we benefited from suffering, what do we do? We cannot judge them to see if their eyes were open or not, but ours are. I respect the resilience of my pioneer ancestors and their strength. And I know that the concept they had, the cultural concept that they had of land ownership, disturbed ways of life that had continued mostly undisturbed for centuries and millennia, where land ownership did not make sense because people such as the Yavapai people of Arizona, they lived in different locations in accordance with the season and what was needed for survival. Such a different concept than my ancestors who staked claim to land and then fenced it. The arrival of my ancestors disturbed the delicate balance that had developed through years of living close to the earth. Of people who were living close to the earth. I have been receiving answers to that question I asked about what do we do? And I've been following them, and that has been leading me to personal experiences of reconciliation with my ancestors and the Indigenous people whose lives they disturbed. I wonder if perhaps coming to terms with our ancestors will lead us into a new role in this world. As I began reconciliation work, what could I do? I was living in Utah, right next to Wyoming. Utah, where my great-grandmother's grandmother, Patty, established an orchard on land that had been crossed for centuries. But as I began to do reconciliation work, I started to see my ancestors differently. I started to see them with more respect and more complexity. And if you perceive them as with us now, perhaps we are the ones who must earn their respect. We are entering new ground, as we do when we discover that someone we loved harmed others or harmed us. And I want to say that sometimes there is a need to keep someone off the ofrenda because the harm continues. If that is your experience, you have that inner knowing and trust that. In seminary, I attended a panel discussion on capital punishment. It was a Quaker seminary, and there was lots of work against capital punishment. I arrived at the last minute, and I ended up on the front row. And soon I realized that I had landed in the middle of the panelists. The woman on my right had lost her mother in a violent act. The man on my left had lost his grandmother in a violent act by teenagers she was tutoring. Both told stories of coming to peace, not just with the loss, but with the people who had committed the acts. Both of those people on either side of me were working to get the people who had done those awful things off of death row. In some cases, relationships had developed. One or two of them had managed to draw the circle of their family big enough to include that person who had robbed them of a grandmother, of a mother. I don't know. I do not know how people do this. But I do know that most of us, including myself, would benefit from expanding our ofrendas. Perhaps a start would be trying to remember the names of all of those who helped you along the way, like Mrs. Nash, teachers, strangers even. I have learned amazing things from strangers. And perhaps with a difficult relative, can you think of one thing you like about them? In one workshop I attended on forgiveness, we were encouraged to think of something that we could like about someone, even if it was simply to give thanks that they were breathing. So you can go even to that point. In this pandemic, I've had a chance to add some forgotten people into my life again. With travel out of the question, I've been calling some friends I have in Japan, and I don't have to wait for a conversation until I see them. I can call or Zoom with them. One friend, Pearl Woolerton, was a woman we only saw when we made a trip to the UK. She's now a regular part of our month. An evangelical Christian, she and her husband Duncan were the wardens of the YWCA, where we stayed on a trip to Edinburgh, where we were performing a play. We had an immediate connection with her, which led to wonderful evenings, laughing and telling stories. She and Duncan felt like families, like a family to us. And through the years, we kept wondering if they were real friends. After all, we never talked about Lou and I being two women together, and they were very evangelical Christians. And in a recent conversation on Zoom, we discovered that on our first visit, their son Simon had had the conversation with them during our first visit. He had asked them, "If you knew that Patty and Mary Lou were a couple, would it change anything? Would you want to be friends?" The answer was yes. And they drew their circle wide. And somehow, after hearing that story, we went with them from dear friends to family. And now Duncan, who passed away last year, is on our ofrenda. Perhaps I'm asking you to include others because I know what it is not to be included, to disappear from people's list of friends or out of the Christmas card list, or to have my photograph disappear from an ofrenda wall. In Coco, you discover that these people on the ofrenda are the ones who become your companions after you die. In the work that I've done to try to include more and more people on my ofrenda, including the women whose name I bear. And I think that even though, especially the one born in 1795, only frowns from photographs, I have come to feel that these people are with me right now. May you find those who could accompany your life. May they be with you in your life. Amen, and may it be so. And now let us listen Let us listen to the sounds around us, the breathing. Let us sing breaths.
Listen more often to things than to things. Listen more often to things than to these. 'Tis the ancestor's bird. When the fire's voice is heard, 'tis the ancestor's bird. In the voice of the waters. Those who have died have never known the land. The dead are not under the earth. They are in the rustling trees. They are in the groaning woods. They are in the crying grass. They are in the moaning rocks. The dead are not under the earth. So listen more often to things than to beings. Listen more often to things than to beings. 'Tis the ancestor's breath. When the fire's voice is heard, 'tis the ancestor's breath. In the voice of the waters. Those who have died have never left. The dead have a pact with the living. They are in the woman's breast. They are in the waiting child. They are with us in the home. They are with us in the crowd. The dead have a pact with the living. So listen more often to things than to beings. Listen more often to things than to beings. 'Tis the ancestor's word. When the fire's voice is heard, 'tis the ancestor's breath. In the voice of the waters. Listen more often to things than to beings. Listen more often to things than to beings.
During this time, when they say that the veil between the world is the thinnest, the world's is the thinnest, during this time when fear is rampant around us, let us gather those who lift us up, those who whisper to us, have courage. I walk before you. Practice compassion, always with ourselves, our ancestors, and the humans in our own homes, our neighborhoods, this state, the country, and the world. Let us seek this week, in this moment, to see the big picture. Let us see what we can be in this world, let us listen to the gathering of spirits by Carrie Newcomer. Before we extinguish our chalice, I want to return to this moment just for a little time. There's a lot of fear-mongering among us, and my final message to you, which I hope you hear over and over, is do not fear. And if something unimaginable happens or imaginable, we have a phone tree that will assure our staying in contact. We're also going to be sending out video messages to keep us together. You are being companioned. And I'm also asking you to please practice safety. Our community has stayed safe, but the world out there is not safe. The numbers are rising of people who are contacting this disease. We are still in a pandemic, and I ask you to be safe, be calm, and know that we are all together and we will be in communication in case there is something. Tomorrow, I was the person elected to speak with Chief Black about what law enforcement is considering for this time. And I will be writing about that. So anyway, be well. And now let us extinguish our chalice together. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. And as questions for your breakout rooms, thank you, Karen, as questions for your breakout rooms, I wonder if you could tell about someone who's on your ofrenda or not on your ofrenda and tell that story. Perhaps someone you'd like to bring back to your ofrenda. Go in peace.